This is your funeral if you die saved. This is Dr. Dallas Billington, pastor of the Baptist Temple, Akron, Ohio, cutting this recording by request, that song, Some Glad Day We'll Move Away. So many people that have loved ones die and go home to be with the Lord, and they come up through a modernist church that never tell them much about Jesus or heaven. They hardly know anything about the Bible. Oftentimes they come to me at a funeral service, and they'll ask me so many questions that to us who grew up in a church like ours here, where we believe in the death of Christ and His crucifixion, His burial, and His coming again. So we have decided to preach your funeral while you are living. Let you sit down and listen to it, and then you'll know what the Bible has to say about you. So we'll say that you were born on a certain day, you lived so many years, old enough to be saved, and you died. If that would be true, we would read these following scriptures from the 14th chapter of John in 3 verses. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. So when you die a Christian and you leave this world, you go to be with the Lord Jesus Christ. So wherever He is, wherever heaven is, wherever God is. Well, what about this? Well, the Bible says it's above the stars. The Bible speaks of three heavens, one where the birds fly and the aeroplanes, and one where the sun, moon, and stars, the Milky Way, and one is God's home, God's eternal dwelling place. And so here Jesus said that He'd go and prepare a home for you. Then He would come again and receive you unto Himself, that where He was, there you would be also. So don't you think it would be heaven to look upon the face of the Lord Jesus Christ? To see the one who was nailed to a cross, who shed His life's blood that you and I might be saved. Don't you think that would be heaven, just to behold His face in glory? There are so many who will come and they'll speak about, I want to see my mother and my brother and my little baby in heaven. Well, who doesn't? But there is one there whose face outshines the sun, and He loved you so much that He died on a cross to save you. And so they make all manner of fun and write all kinds of funny songs, but we like to stick to the songs that tell us more about heaven and about the Lord Jesus Christ. So the 14th chapter of John says that Jesus said He would prepare a home, and then He would come again. But they make fun of us when we use the old song, In the Sweet By and By. But I want you to listen to this great choir while they sing, In the Sweet By and By.
In the sweet by and by.
So according to our Bible, when we draw our last breath and the doctor walks out into the room, yonder the little waiting room in some hospital, someplace, and he says, she is gone, he is gone, they are gone. That's just exactly what our Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 1. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God, a house not made with hands, in the heavens. Therefore, we're always confident, knowing that while we're at home in this body, we're absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. So when someone comes and tells you about a precious loved one, she is gone, he is gone, they're gone. They are gone to be with the Lord. Remember, we're referring to Christian people. But I would have to say something here. But Dr. Bill, how about my baby? How about my little child? How about my little boy and little girl? Well, I love the old song that says, where the roses never fade, and full-blooming flowers will not always do. God gathers buds too. Now listen closely. The Bible teaches us that all babies, now I don't care who they are, all children, makes no difference, until they are old enough to sin against God. Jesus Christ died for sinners. And so I want to make sure I get this in where you won't worry. Don't have your little baby sprinkled to take away its sins and call it baptized. And don't run off somewhere and say, my baby's a sinner, and therefore I know I'll have to do something for it. No, you don't. The Bible tells us plainly, so plain, when Jesus was asked, who is the greatest in heaven? He called this little child unto him and set him in the midst and said, except you be converted and be like this little child, you shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. Old Joe way back there said, if a man dies, shall he live again? All of my years will I wait till my chains come. Then he talks about a tree. That's the 14th chapter of the book of Job. Then he talks about a tree that you can cut the stump off and the roots stay in the ground and it'll sprout again. And then Jesus said in the 12th chapter of John, except a grain of corn of wheat die, it abides alone. So we believe in death and we believe in burying the old body. And so our Bible tells us so plainly, and I'd like to tell you this, then shall the dust return to the earth as it was, and the spirit shall return unto God who gave it. And so what we call the real life of man, the real life of woman, it's referred to as the soul of man, for the soul of man never dies. When your face is cold and your fingers have straightened out and the doctors have pronounced you cold and dead, the Bible says, then your spirit goes to be with God. So don't worry, don't worry. You are saved and you are a Christian. A boy or girl, teenager, or a man or woman that's old enough to accept Christ as Savior. Only saved people go to heaven. And all little babies and small children not old enough to sin are saved, having not sinned. Then those of us who have believed in the Lord Jesus Christ. So then I like to have a word here to the loved ones who will be left behind when you are gone, when you're cold and in your casket and they're singing songs around you, they're having the last service. If you would have been dead 3 days, you would have been already 3 days in heaven. We have established this truth from both the Old and the New Testament by the Spirit returning to God who gave it and absent from the body, present with the Lord. So when they're standing around your body and singing and shedding tears and crying, you will already would have been at home with Jesus for 3 days in the state of Ohio. Why? Because you are a Christian. So it pays to be saved now. It's the only way you can be assured of the city of God is to be saved while you have your right mind, while people can talk to you. But Dr. Billington, I don't know if I know how to be saved or not, the living will say. All right, at the funeral service, we'll tell you how she got saved. She was a Sunday school teacher. He was an usher. They sang in the choir. They worked on the parking lot. They operated the radio room. They sat in the pew. They paid. They prayed. They sent out missionaries. We worked together. And now she or he is gone, regardless of whether it be a man or woman that we're having your funeral service for. Now then, we'll tell you how they got saved. One time, somewhere, they heard the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Somebody told them at Romans 10:13 said, for whosoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So they prayed. They asked the Lord to save them. Then in 1 John 1:9, it says, if we will confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. They have done that. They believed in Christ. They confessed their sins, not enumerate them and tell God what they had done. He already knew. They simply prayed a prayer like this, Lord, forgive my sins and save me. So now while we stand around the open casket and we do not see, but the Bible tells us plainly that the angels carries the soul to be with God. In the 16th chapter of the book of Luke's gospel, it says there was a sick man that laid at a man's gate full of sores and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from his table, and he died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. So, at all funeral services that you may attend, there'll be people known as pallbearers. And they'll carry the body out, yonder, to its final resting place, but the soul has already, 3 days ago, been carried by the angels home to be with God. Then another scripture I like to think of, 7th chapter of the book of Acts, old Stephen's when he was dying, when the God of heaven had shut the lights off on this world, and no doubt he had lost all sight of man and woman standing around his bedside, he turned his eyes toward heaven. And he said, I see heaven open, and I see Jesus Christ standing at the right hand of God. And so we have so much to thank the Lord for along the line. Now then, I'd like to give you just a few things to think about when we get to heaven. And so many sorrows down here in this world of sin and sorrow. So I like to think about some things. I heard Charles preach this sermon first. I won't steal his material and not tell you. I heard Charles preach one time on some things that will not be in heaven. So here are some of the things that the Bible speaks about. This is Revelation chapter 21 and verse 3. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, behold, the tabernacle of God is with men. And he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. So that's some of the things we can look forward to in the city of God, that there will be no pain there, there'll be no sorrow, and there'll be no death. Every now and then someone comes along and says, Dr. Billington, what will we be like in heaven? Well, our Bible tells us also in the book of Revelation what we will be like. We sang an old song out here, For You I Am Praying. And so here we find these words in the 7th chapter of the book of Revelation. After this I beheld, and lo, a multitude which no man could number, of all nations and kindreds and people and tongue, stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hand, and cried with a loud voice, saying, Salvation to our God which sitteth upon the throne, and unto the Lamb. And all the angels stood round about the throne, and about the elders and the four beasts, and fell before the throne on their faces, and worshipped God, saying, Amen, blessings and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be unto our God forever and ever. Now please listen. One of the elders answered, saying unto me, What are these which are arrayed in white robes, and whence came they? In other words, where did they come from? And I said unto him, Sir, thou knowest. And he said unto me, These are they which have come out of great tribulation, have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. It takes the blood of Jesus Christ to cleanse you and save you and make you white. Those who have sinned against God can be saved or cleansed no other way, only in and through and by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. So, after his crucifixion, after his burial and his resurrection, in Revelation 1:18, he said, I am he that liveth, and I was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore, and I have the keys of death and of hell. O death, where is thy sting? And O grave, where is thy victory? So then someone else comes along, and in 1 Corinthians, they said, But what kind of body will I have? So in the 49th verse of the 15th chapter, 1 Corinthians says, As we have borne this earthly body, so shall we bear that heavenly body. And it will be a tangible body, a touchable body. You can take your baby in your arms and hold it in your arms. You can behold your loved ones again and see them and be glad. The Lord Jesus Christ was a proof of that. Then for those of you who have a girl or a boy gone, and will say she was 12, 13, 15, at the age of 12, a little girl died. And Jesus was sent for, and he came, and he raised her from the dead and gave her back to her parents just like she was, a 12-year-old girl. Two girls weeping and crying said, Our brother is dead, Lazarus, 11th chapter of the book of St. John. And they said to Jesus, But it's too late now, Lord Jesus. It's too late. He's been dead 4 days, and he now stinketh. And he said, Where have you, lady? Oh, how sweet and tender Jesus could be. Where have you put him? Like the doctor, when he comes and the little baby is so sick, he'd say, Where's the baby at? Or he comes into the hospital and the family's all out in the waiting room somewhere, and he said, What room is the patient in? And he walks slowly down the hall. And so the Lord Jesus Christ said, Where have you put him? He already knew, but he wanted to play the part of a man that they might understand. And so that's exactly what he said. So one by one, seats are empty. You know that. One by one, we are being gathered home. And everyone that's ever written about a place over yonder, Daniel spoke about it in the 12th chapter of Daniel. He said, I saw a man in his white linen coat out on the river. I saw some on the other side and some on this side. And that's what happens when our loved ones begin to die and to steal away and slip away home. There's some across the river on heaven's shore and some already on this side. And so we as Baptist people like to sing that old song. Listen to me, will you? Shall we gather at the river? And you call it the river of death. We call it the river of crossing into eternal life. Listen while they sing it. After they had crucified the Lord Jesus Christ and placed him out yonder in that tomb, and they had sealed that Roman tomb with the signet of the Roman government, on the third morning they went down, and here's what we find. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come see the place where the Lord lay. So you come with me out here to one of Akron's cemeteries, and we'll find the flowers budding and the moss growing over the top of these graves. And I can say to you, they are not here. They live on the other side of the river with God. And so, I am preaching your funeral while you're still living. If you are a Christian, have no fear, because after God saves you, he will keep you for all eternity. You say, but I'm afraid, I'm worried, I'm afraid to die. You don't need to be. Jesus tells us plainly that when we come to walk through the valley of the shadow of death, he will be with us. And so let me say this to you. Sit down and play this recording and play it back and say, that's me. Someone has already preached my funeral and I'm not afraid to die. Jesus has gone to prepare a home for me. Then he said I'd be with him some glad morning over yonder. The old prophet said that I was only a lump of dust and I'd go back to the dust while my soul would go back to God. And I'd be at home with Jesus for all eternity. And so let me say this to you kindly now. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. Whoever may have your funeral when you come to die, when you've passed across unto God's tomorrow, you'll have no sorrows and no regrets. It'll all be over with for all eternity. And one more time we want to say to you, listen now, all you are at death is a cold, tallow face. So many times I've had to, too many times for my own good, say to the little boys and girls as we'd lead them up slowly to the casket. And there we'd let them kiss a face and try to tell them if they were old enough, Mommy is still living. Well, where is Mommy? She's gone to be with Jesus, and someday you can go. Songwriters do more, I think, than all preachers of all times along this line. I have gone with men and stood along with the open casket where the little wife lay and the children gathered around. I have gone with the women where the husband lay there. I have gone with fathers and mothers for the teenagers just in youth with their wavy hair and all of these things. Oh, what a privilege it is for a preacher when he can come to preach a funeral of a saved person or the little baby, the little boy, the little girl that has no worry about sin. We know where they are. They've gone to be with Jesus. And the Bible says plainly, it is appointed for men once to die. You have to die. God said, get your house in order. You'll die and not live. There waits for you a day of death. You cannot escape it. It's bound to come. It will come. But the greatest thing of all times, just before they close that casket lid for the last time, if we can say we'll behold their face again and be glad. Oh, come angel band, come in around me stand, bear me away on your snowy wings to my immortal home. That's the death of a righteous man. That's the death of a Christian. And so we want you to believe that. We want you to believe that when you come to die, you'll have no sorrows, no regret, if you have been saved. And the Bible tells you plainly in Romans 10:13, if you have called on the Lord, if you have confessed your sins are gone, and truly you will be at home with Jesus. So then what must we do? We must come home by the way of the cross. We'll tell the people at your funeral service that you're not here, you don't live here anymore. If they want to come and see you, they'll have to come to meet you, but they'll all have to come by the way of the cross. And then, finally, the old coal miner comes home and he said, I'm glad to be home. The tar builder comes home, the pit man, the working man, the road builder, and it's good to be at home. And Jack Vandal wrote the song that walking along life's road one day, I heard a voice so sweetly say, up in heaven, I'm building for you a beautiful, beautiful home. Listen while the choir closes this. I shall be at home with Jesus while eternal ages roll. This is your funeral if you die unsaved. I want to read to you some scriptures from the Holy Bible found in Proverbs, the first chapter. Turn you at my reproof. Behold, I will pour out my spirit unto you. I will make known my words unto you, because I have called and you refused. I have stretched out my hand and no man regarded. This scripture, of course, is written for unsaved people, those that reject Jesus Christ as Savior. His precious blood that flowed on Calvary that all men might be saved. But when we reject the blood of Christ and the story of God's Son, then when we die unsaved, ungodly, and because of that, we are turned away from God and we send ourselves to hell. Nobody sends us there. The Bible says in Isaiah 38, get your house in order, you are going to die and not live. That's the whole human race. That's presidents and kings and rabbis and priests and preachers and fathers and mothers and little babies. But remember, you have to grow up to be old enough to know right from wrong, to die a sinner. Only sinners go to hell, only Christ rejecters. When you reject the blood of Christ and turn your back upon him, you die. So at the funeral service, we'll say, Mr. So-and-so, he lived and died. And then for this family's sake, that's all we can say, for we have to be Christian about the thing who are living. And after all, we respect the wife and the widows, or the husband and so forth. But the unsaved, the deceased who now lies before me, died unsaved according to the scriptures, according to his life or her life. And so that means to die unsaved means to spend eternity away from God and forever. Oftentimes through life you attend revival meetings, you listen to radio broadcast, and they'll tell you how to be saved. And you'll say, I don't have time. I have to go here tonight and yonder tomorrow night. You have no time to attend the revivals. And so the Bible says in Proverbs 29, he that being often reproved hardened his neck shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. I want you to listen at this old song, Prepare to Meet Thy God. Listen while they sing, won't you? Preached at my church on Sunday night and have men all but make fun of the gospel of Jesus Christ and fade away into the dark and out into the night, never to darken a church door again, to die somewhere on a highway in a crash, or to die of a heart attack. And they call me from the factory where they worked and say he died suddenly. He just slipped down behind his machine and he was gone. So God made no mistake when he said, he that's often reproved and hardened his neck shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. You have many invitations and you keep turning them down. But here is this sad one, I think, so much. The Bible tells us of these people, procrastination. Now, Dr. Billington, I'm going to be a Christian, but I tell you what I'll do. I'll be back next Sunday. I will be back tomorrow. And I will do this and I'll do that. But tomorrow never comes for them. So in James, the 4th chapter and 14th verse, whereas you know not what shall be on the morrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appeareth for a little time and then vanisheth away. Life is so short. A vapor of water put on the desk when I start to read a text, when I am finished, it's all dried away and gone. And God compares your life to eternity to being just that short. What is your life when you boast of the fact, I'll be back tomorrow, just give me time. I'll see you again. Don't bother me tonight. Don't talk to me about being saved. I don't want to be saved now. Oh, I want to sometime, but not now. So you say tomorrow. So out here we sing songs, someday there will be no tomorrow. And so if you die tonight, you never see the sunrise of another day. There will be no tomorrow for you. And that means if you die unsaved, you will be unsaved for a million and a million years. A lot of people say, well, but I tell you, Brother Billington, if I don't get saved now, I will later. So in Psalms 49, they that trust in their wealth and boast themselves in the multitude of their riches, none of them can by any means redeem his brother, nor give to God a ransom for him. For the redemption of their soul is precious, and it ceases forever. When you draw your last breath, God bless your heart, it's all over with. No more invitations for you. No, no, that's gone and gone forever. So we beg, plead, and pray while you live to get you to Christ. And you say, not now, not now, some other time. Then lots of people say, well, Dr. Bill, do you think God will turn me into hell? Will he send me to hell? I read in a newspaper in the state of Arizona where the judge sentenced a man who had killed 3 girls. And the last thing he said to that dear man, the jury found you guilty because of your deed. And now, he said, this is the second time with me in 20 long years as a judge on the bench, I must pronounce to you what the state requires, that you shall die in the gas chamber according to the law of the land. May God have mercy on your soul. Now, that man was still living. There's no mercy for your soul after you die. Sometime a preacher will say at the funeral or at the graveside of an unsaved man, and now we leave his soul in the hands of a merciful God. That isn't true. Mercy ends when you draw your last breath. It is over with forever. So if you die unsaved, here we find the scriptures. The wicked shall be turned into hell and all the nations that forget God. All you have to do to go to hell is just forget to get saved, forget God, for we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. And so this is your funeral. If you die unsaved, this is your funeral. This is you, whether you be a man or a woman or a boy or a girl, old enough to know right from wrong. Of course, no little children go to hell regardless of their race, creed, or nationality. But after we have sinned against God and we have had the knowledge of God, and the Bible says it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands and the wrath of a jealous God. So when you reject the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, you bring the wrath of God down upon you. Christ died upon a cross, and his blood that stained the old rugged cross is to keep you out of hell. And we sing the old songs, and we beg, and we plead, and we do everything in the world. But it's almost too late. So let me read this to you. Matthew 25:32, and before him shall be gathered all nations, and he shall separate them one from another, as a sheep divideth his sheep from the goats. And to the unsaved and the wicked, he says, depart from me, for I never knew you. Listen to this old song, almost persuaded. And while you're still living and listening to somebody's funeral, you be all the way persuaded to take Christ as Savior, while they sing, almost persuaded. So many people in the world who think that you have to be a harlot or a murderer or do some hideous crime in order to die and go to hell. In Revelation 21:8, but the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and the murderer and the whoremonger and the sorcerer and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. And the one to head that list is the fearful. Dr. Billington, I'm afraid of the crowd. I'm afraid of what my buddies will say about me down at the shop. I'm afraid of what my friends may think about me. And then I'm a member of a church, you know, already, and I could not afford to leave my church and come and join your church. I'm not talking about joining churches. The book of God doesn't speak so much about that. Only it says they that are saved. I'm talking about you dying unsaved. I'm talking about you being afraid to face those on earth. And before you would turn to God, you would go on and let the crowd laugh at you and make fun of you and drag you down and down and down. I'd like to just tell you this. In the Bible, the 25th chapter of Matthew, it says there'll be virgins in hell. The Bible tells you that. 25th chapter of Matthew, read, there'll be girls with perfect character, women that have perfect character. they'll die unsaved and go to hell because they would not believe. They were afraid of the crowd. They were afraid to leave. And so because of that great truth, they're turned away into hell because of their sin. And then someone wants to keep saying, but I didn't think a good Lord would send me to hell. I beg you, as a man of God and one who loves you, God has never sent no one to hell. Like the judge said to that fine man, he was a fine man, only he had killed 3 girls in the state of Arizona. And I was there when the trial was there, as you've heard me say, and so on and on. And so there's another class that I feel sorry for that's going to hell, and that is the class that's called of the cloth. And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophets are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. Yes, there'll be preachers of the cloth. There'll be every religious faith will be there because they refuse to turn to God and take Him as their Savior. And so the Bible tells you because of that. Just think of that, the false prophets. And so we read again in the Bible over and over again where the Bible tells us these things. And now we come to just plead with you in these closing hours. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. Now wait a minute. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire. My last scripture I want to read to you is found in Luke, the 16th chapter and 23rd verse. He died and was buried, and in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torment. Somebody will get me out. No, in the same chapter says there's a great gulf fixed and no one can cross it. Your father, your mother, your religious leaders, and the money that you have that you want to spend to buy your way out. I read to you from Psalms 29, says their redemption ceases forever, and with your money you cannot buy. Let me say to you in closing, in a hospital one night, a wife and a mother stood with me and said, Dr. Billington, can't you help this man? His wrist was chained to both sides of the bed, and he was crying, help me, help me, help me. And the doctor and the nurse told me that he was delirious. He didn't know what he was talking about. He would curse. He would take God's name in vain. And such horrible words. And so would you want to say that God sent him to hell? No, just like the murderer. He sent himself there, but not having any time at all to get ready to meet God. And so I thought it would be fine if I could have this little talk with you and let you hear your own funeral. Because at your funeral service, I'll love your family too much to tell them that you're gone to hell. But you're not my judge. No, but you judge yourself. The Bible says, the way a tree falls, so shall it lie. So let's go back now. He that's often reproved, that's you in the invitation hour. You listened to the broadcast. You heard the gospel. You read the gospel. Someone gave you a gospel tract down at work and you laughed about it. Someone told you, your buddy, but you said, I'll have plenty of time and I'll put it off. And so the Bible tells me in the 6th chapter of Revelation of all of the types of men that's going to hell. And you'd be surprised, it would actually scare you when you read the long, long list of how many is going. And nobody's barred from that list, not anyone of any walk of life. So you wouldn't have to think, well, I'm better than someone else and I'll make it. I want to read you that list in my last remarks because I think they're better than anything else. And I beheld when he had opened the 6th seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake. And the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood. And the stars of heaven fell to the earth, even as a fig cast her untimely fig. And the heaven departed as a scroll and is rolled together, and every mountain and island were moved out of their places. And the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, and every bondman and every free man, hid themselves in the dens and in the rocks of the mountains, and said to the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? This great state of Ohio and the state of Kentucky where I grew up, and the laws of the land give us our freedom. Let us go and do as we please, so long as we please to do right. But then if we do not, we have the civil law that brings us into judgment. Now I want this 2 last minutes with you. I'm in your hospital room. I'm in your house. I'm in your home. And you're unconscious now. It's too late to pray. I can't show you any scripture now. I can't sing no more songs for you. I can't give you any more invitations. All we can do is stand by and wait. Just wait and wait. It's growing dark around you now. Oh, it seems so dark. This is the darkest dark that I have ever seen. The sun is set for the last time upon you. The old brow is growing cold now and sticky with sweat. And you're dying unsaved. You're crying for water and there won't be none. You're begging for water. The Bible says you will and there won't be none. And then I'd like to tell you this one last thing. It says there'll be weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Just as sure As the resurrection of the righteous have a body, so will the unsaved have a body. And you'll weep and wail and gnash your teeth. Your memory will come back to you. You'll remember every invitation song. You'll remember everyone who ever asked you to be a Christian. If you had a Christian mother, wife, or husband, or someone to pray for you, you'll remember their prayers. You'll pray, but your prayer will be late. Our Father, we pray that you would bless this message and use it for God's glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now will you listen? The great judgment morning. God bless you.
I dream that the great judgment